There is duty and there is authority. And on top of that, just to cheat you, they will tell you you are free. This is how stupid people are. That's how you cheat Shudra. You give him a big title. You are the chief manager of the hygienic, you know, institution, division number 6, when there is a, you know, hygienic disposal department. Actually, you are a garbage man, that's all. You're just a garbage man who hangs on a truck and goes, you know, and throws garbage in the back of the truck. That's all. But they give you a nice outfit and they give you a nice truck and you look great. I never saw such a puffed up garbage man in Denmark. I never saw such a puffed up garbage man like in Denmark. The cars are polished, they're completely clean, you know. They have a brand new gloves and brand new outfit and two mobile phones and, hey, the garbage is ready. Yeah! I mean, such a deluxe garbage company like in Denmark, I never saw anything like that. You know, in Czech Republic you have to bring your own dress, you know, they all look like they hang on these trucks and, you know, and throw the garbage in. You know, I hear even it's one of the best paid jobs. You know, very deluxe, and you look at their faces and you go, I will not pick up this bag extra. You give me one box of Coca-Cola, that's it. Come on. His divine grace, garbage man. I could punch the man in the face if I would follow my instinct immediately, because that's how you treat children. First comes the stick, then comes the lecture. No? Oh, Denmark. I'll be ending up in jail. Violation of human rights. Thank you very much. Well, this country goes to hell, no doubt. No cleansing of heart for such fellows. So-called renunciation for the purpose of maintenance is never approved by the Lord, nor by any religious scripture. After all, one is to maintain one's body and soul together by some work. Work should not be given up capriciously without purification of materialistic propensities. Because any kind of work, even the one you like, will bring austerity to you. If you do it in a sense of duty, it will be austerity. Anyone who is in the material world is certainly possessed of the impure propensity for lording it over material nature, or in other words, for sense gratification. Such polluted propensities have to be cleared. Without doing so, through prescribed duties, one should never attempt to become a so-called transcendentalist, renouncing work and living at the cost of others. So this is a heavy, heavy, heavy warning for everyone. And actually, the higher you go, the more, you could say, respected position you have while practicing spiritual life, the greater responsibility it is, because people will come and give you. They will give you energy, they will give you money, they will give you their life. I don't want to be too autobiographic, but one of the most terrifying experiences in my life was when I was placed in a situation where people kind of were starting to indicate that they are ready to offer their lives to me. And this terrifying feeling. I was horrified. I ran back from Czech Republic to Sweden and I was going, oh, they want me to become the guru. Oh. You know, I was scared. You know what that means? What about if that person takes each single thing you say? And each single thing you do, they will follow. The Prabhupada went with the cup like this. And to a great surprise from everybody, he lifted up the cup like sky high. In the lecture, while he was lecturing, he was going and put it back. He was going, wow! They never saw anything like this. It didn't take one day. The devotee giving lecture had a cup and he was going, and Krishna sells, and all that. And he took a full shower. Because nobody knew that art of really doing it in such a wonderful way. When Prabhupada was giving lecture,
And while giving lecture, he was actually twisting his long hair, which came out of his ears. Not all people have such a long hair coming out of ears like Prabhupada. So he was going like this. It didn't took one day. The devotee giving lecture said, and Prabhupada said, you know, and there was no hair. There was no hair. He just, Prabhupada said, oh, Prabhupada made this. This was so gently done. So of course, it didn't took again. One day, he was in Prabhupada's head. He completely messed up. So, this is what it means to become a guru. It's heavy. They will watch you even pass through and say that. It's so bad. So try to imagine yourself in that situation. Because now we are just by Dr. Joe. It's a quite luxurious way. You can do actually quite a few things and okay. But then you are in such a responsible position, your privacy is gone. You are living in a shopping window. Everybody will come in and for sure somebody will realize, this is Kali Yuga, get ready for that. Anybody assuming any kind of responsible position in this material world, in this time, will be criticized, of course. There's no respect to authority, he'll be envied. For no reason. Prabhupada was envied for things which is ridiculous. They will envy sannyasi even for a water pot. You know, they will envy sannyasi for a danda, which is 3-4 bamboo sticks tied together. That's such a big danda, why does he think what he is? The envy is so fake. This whole socialism, communism, it's all completely built on envy. It carries these wonderful ideas of unity and brotherhood and this. No, envy. They're all the same. Don't dare to stick up your head. Don't dare to tell me you are a professor. We are our coal miner. That's the hero. He is digging and digging and digging and digging and with a blood in the face. That's the hero. So it's not the same. There'll be always somebody glorified and somebody despised. There'll be always somebody, you know, advertised and somebody not advertised. So the best thing is not to bother. The best thing is to focus on the essential thing of life. And what is the essential thing of life? Somewhere to become to one's capacity. Part of Srila Prabhupada's mission. That's what counts. All the other things that we have, the problems with eating, sleeping, mating and defending. One of my very advanced god brothers who came to, after many years of preaching, who concluded for himself, he said, I am so tired to hear about these damn social issues. And I know how he came to that point. We have social issues. We have Varashnadama. Varashnadama means social issues. How do we relate to each other in a material world and all this? But then you overdo it, and that usually comes when the females become prominent. When the females are very socially aware, so they are extremely socially sensitive beings, men are sometimes quite asocial. They flock together for the sake of doing something together and kicking a ball and yeah, you know, but they are not really so much refined, especially in sugar category. But women, they are just, And it's also necessary sometimes. The combination can be very productive. Still, the sensitivity is dominated in the material world by the fact that we are dying. You cannot say, how do you feel when you die? As we mentioned, Prabhupada gave the ultimate example by being on his deathbed. He didn't go anywhere anymore. And he knew maybe I have 1 week to live. You get a warning. His body was totally falling apart. And he died, as we mentioned yesterday, in defying any sort of privacy, that's exemplary, in public view, you know. And as we mentioned yesterday, first actually he got tired of public, because people were coming in his room, going, ah, Samaji, you look so bad, how are you? He got angry, Prabhupada said, I am dying, and they ask, how are you?
They are wasting my time. I don't want any visitors. Get them all out. Let's go about teaching the consciousness and, you know, out. To the sannyasis, of course, they were thinking, everybody out! You know, close the door. And then nobody came. Then Prabhupada said, action is not good. Now nobody comes. Let them all come. So then the door was open. And you know what it leads to die? Fever is unpredictable. Your organs are failing one after another. It went to a point where Prabhupada was discussing some issue with Ramakrishna Maharaj while stool came out of his body. And Ramakrishna Maharaj was, oh, Prabhupada, Prabhupada said, don't bother, it's not so important. You know, get on talking. Totally beyond any bodily concept. Totally. That's it. That doesn't mean we should follow it, you know, and preach with stool hanging from our bodies. That's not the point. But, you know, we have to look reasonably. Please, let's remember that and strive for that. To help the conditioned soul to perceive us as being somewhat representative. It doesn't mean you have a giant suit all the time and going along. I know the Buddhists who came to conclude like that, you know, you grow nice hair, hair cutting, you know, Bhagavad Gita. Well, then you look like them. They go, nice guy, yeah, but very interesting. All this academic preaching is sometimes can become like this, just an exchange of courtesy. It's very important. Very interesting. What did you say? Surrender to Krishna. Very, very. Yeah, this is what Prabhupada was not. Somebody sent me a beautiful photo of Prabhupada who is caught in the midst of action. He just goes out of the house for some walk and somebody was suddenly standing there with a camera, took a shot. This is a picture you don't find in the puja books. Because Prabhupada looks with the, like with a beatback like, wow, you know, like, wow, what do you want? You know, just like caught in the midst of action, you know. I like this picture specifically because it's so normal, it's so, you know, it's so practical. You know, this is not the picture of Prabhupada you see being as the representative of the International Society of Krishna Consciousness. This is Prabhupada in action. This is Prabhupada doing things. This is Prabhupada being tired. This is Prabhupada being angry. This is Prabhupada being in ecstasy. This is Prabhupada having a whole range of human emotions, which we sometimes defy in the name of Krishna consciousness. The camera.
Oh, sorry.
I don't know. So, Prabhupada was normal. You know, Prabhupada was not normal in that mundane sense, he was normal in the spiritual sense. He was common sense. Sometimes he listened and people were going, Prabhupada, it's nice, you said we should do it, but look, because of this and this and this, it's very difficult to do. Then Prabhupada said, oh, then we don't do it. Prabhupada, with great enthusiasm, printed our own first books, printed our own printing press. Until it was found out that actually it's very complicated, expensive, nobody knows really how to do this, we cannot achieve the qualities the kind is produced. Prabhupada said, oh, just give it up. Then he found devotees in a farm in the midst of hostile area with snow and who knows what. He said, what do you want to farm here? It's just mud and snow. Come on, close it down. And they're going, oh, joy, great instruction. Let's get rid of this. This is useless. We just suffer here in the middle of nowhere. So Prabhupada was very practical. Everything had very used. Like Prabhupada liked big castles. We know that. But we know how hellishly impractical big buildings are. How difficult it is to maintain such an establishment. You know. But Prabhupada viewed these castles not as castles where we sit and go, yes, Arctic, very nice. You know, with gold leaf on the roof. That's nice. But he viewed them as farming communities. You do normally farmers don't live in a castle. No, a Prabhupada's concept they do. Wonderful. Why? Because the castle is for Krishna. You farm. This was never really understood. Never. Yeah, I want to go into the story. It became a competition of castles. Who has the biggest castle in this yatra? Everybody had a big castle. We made it. Krishna was established. It's a big castle. You know? And you know, you cannot imagine how ghostly haunted these buildings also are. Unbelievable. You know, because all the people who were building these castles, they were so attached to it, so they are still there. You know? And then some of them, they don't like Hare Krishna. You know? Some people were screaming at me, oh, there's a ghost! Ah! You know? But when you chant, of course, these ghosts, they go. They're also friendly ghosts. They like chanting. Anyway. You have to give a ghost lecture. But so much trouble to maintain these buildings. At the end, you just collect for maintaining the building. You compromise the philosophy. Please come in. We'll make a seminar on Kama Sutra. Great, come in. Just give us some cash. We need some cash. You know what? The chimney is falling off the roof. And we have, on this building, 60 chimneys. This is a preaching. Come to Krishna consciousness. Learn something about Kama Sutra. And give us some money so we can fix the chimney. You know, this is what these big buildings can do to you. I have no doubt on a certain point, Prabhupada said, just get rid of it. Prabhupada said in his letters, where do you find it? He said, we can preach under a tree, happily. We don't need this. But for the public, it's nice. But what happened? In France, I think, was the most concentrated accumulation of castles, I think. So the three castles or something like this. Yeah, three castles. Big three castles. That was enough for the French people. Hare Krishna having three big castles. That's too much. So the devotees found themselves one night waking up in a castle surrounded by a ring of burning gummi tigers, you know. The local French Ku Klux Klan got upset. This is what you do, you provoke so much envy and so much hate, you know. Why to do things like this? Why to stay with the people? Stay with them. And so we can do that. Our lives have to be always somewhat intact. You cannot preach from a collapsed life, collapsed building, collapsed, you know, chaotic circumstance. You can. You can share the misery with the others. But what people look for really is a person who can balance his life, who can survive all the things which come to him. This is why Amrita, even whatever form in Amrita, was so potent to distribute on the street. Because people read this story of Prabhupada, and even not understanding Bhagavad Gita and Bhagavatam, they got so moved. I met on the street completely mundane people who read this book somewhere, because people like to read biographies. So they read this book and they just, what this man went through, you know. There was a guy I met, a really normal, fat German, you know, he said, I read this book, I was crying. What this man had to go through, you know. So this is what actually makes people to be attracted, and they see us conducting our lives, despite all the defeat, despite all these things. When they see devotees staying faithful, when they see devotees assuming a line of organized life, discipline, you know, things. But this is certainly inspiring to some people. Prabhupada is saying, commenting on the shloka where Krishna says, Sefo Arjuna, surrendering all your works unto me with full knowledge of me, without desires for profit, with no claim of proprietorship, and free from lethargy, fight. And then Prabhupada writes, this verse clearly indicates the purpose of Bhagavad Gita. The Lord instructs that one has to become fully Krishna conscious to discharge duties as if in military discipline. Such an injunction may make things a little difficult. Nevertheless, duties must be carried out with dependence on Krishna because that is the constitutional position of the living entity. By acting in this way, despite all the pressure of duty, authority, everything, you find yourself suddenly ecstatic and you don't even know why. Why? Because you are you. That's you. That's called constitution. And all these various forms of declarations of independence makes people only miserable. Miserable. There is no happy divorced woman, there is no happy divorced man, there is no happy divorced devotee who divorced himself from the instruction of Krishna. These are all different forms of declaration of And the pathetic about devotees is that they still keep on chanting, which means, Krishna, please engage me in your service. But murder! Kind of contradictory. It comes to a crisis. Yes, I want to serve Krishna, but hey, listen, what I have to know. My way. And therefore, generally, after a while, you give up the chanting because it's so disturbing to your personal ideas and plans. So chanting is not a means to make income. Chanting is not a means to make career. Chanting is simply a Krishna engagement in your service. How do you want to find what your service is? You need guidance. There are so many different things one can do in Krishna consciousness. What is the priority? Who is important and who is not so important? Why did Prabhupada certain devotees called my big guns? And then there was a smaller guns. But it's all one army. Prabhupada was not discriminating in that sense. But why did he entrust it certain things to certain devotees and certain devotees not? We were all around. Prabhupada would say, you, come, do this. And he did randomly sometimes. Prabhupada was so empowered, he could pick up even a man from a garbage can and make and induce him to make things, which, you know. Maybe you notice if you get a book from my godmother, and don't, it's not you read first Prabhupada's books, but if you get a book called Biography, it doesn't contain much information about the present and future. It only describes what I have done in the past. Why? Because Prabhupada was here. Should understand actually the background. Why is it so glorious what he has done? Well, he was under direction of Prabhupada. But this is not just about past. This can happen now in the present, and this can happen also in the future. Therefore, the lyrics are definitely wrong because they take the right from Prabhupada away that you cannot empower people anymore. Why? Because you are not physically present. It couldn't be more bodily. You don't have to. Spiritual personalities don't have to be physically present to empower you. That power comes from the heart. They are so wrong and so offensive. How can you say about Prabhupada? You could empower all the people when you were here sitting on this chair. When you left, no more empowerment. So offensive to say about Prabhupada. So insulting to take away. How did Prabhupada get empowered? How many times he saw a spiritual master? His spiritual master left relatively early. Prabhupada was still quite a young man when Bhaktisiddhanta Maharaj left this planet. So how come that he got empowered to spread Krishna consciousness all over the world? In absence of Bhaktisiddhanta Maharaj. This Ritvikra, which is defying the whole principle of parampara, totally. And it doesn't matter how many gurus experience, how many troubles, and how many generals get shot in a battlefield. That's not so important. And it is heavy. However, I don't even describe it, but it's heavy. It's very heavy loss for the army when a general gets shot. But that doesn't change the principle of the structure of the army. Doesn't change anything on the principle how military affairs should be conducted. So it's such a festival of brainlessness. As Einstein said, you know, maybe the universe is unlimited, endless, because he really could couldn't imagine that it could be endless. And, you know, but one thing I'm sure, what is never ending, what is endless, is human stupidity. There seems to be no limits to it. When you have a little bit of brain, it's like, you know, it's like, you know, Ananda Abudi Nandanana was ever expanding stupidity. I mean, people can just stop it, it's unbelievable. You think, but it hurts you right now, don't you get it? They go, it's not pain, it's pleasure. Prabhupada defines stupidity in an example of a camel who picks thorny twigs from the tree and chews on them and cuts his whole mouth bloody. And he thinks, what a nice taste, this twigs. And he takes more. He's bleeding from his mouth, and he thinks, that's a nice taste. He's eating his own blood. That's careful. Just the sound that animal produces is really symptomatic, you know. And he spits. When he doesn't like you, he spits on you. He has this big mouth like a monkey. And you operate it kind of like kicking. Bam, kick him in the belly, he gets up. Kick him in the belly, he goes down. He doesn't understand any other language. So this is the mentality of people today. Unbelievable. Eating like a drug, you know, enslaved with 50% tax, you know, working for meaningless purposes. As long as I have my TV and I can listen what they tell me to think, I'm happy man. Every evening they collect it from the altar, you know, switch the program and they go, so what did you tell me? And some stupid Swedish kid called politician, Danish kid called politician goes, it's called discussion. And they discuss more. Serious. They think, oh, I don't understand anything what they are talking, but I will switch to another program that's called kicking the ball. Or punching the ball, or whatever it is, it's called sport. You know, bunch of guys goes, and they ask him, what do you think about the situation in the world? What is your opinion about philosophy? He goes, well, we have to kick it all. We have to kick it off, you know. They go, very interesting what this champion said, sport champion, sport. Just give it. This is the level of intellectuality we are facing. So please, let's not get lost in details. We are preaching in a, you know, in a zoo, we too cultivated expression. In a zoo, they are organized. We are preaching in a zoo, which is out of control. So let's be practical. Let's see our own situation, you know, our thinking, and let's follow the simple instructions, Krishna.
Namo Nishindraya Krishna 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 Krishna